So I said, unfortunately, I am the speaker. So let me
Exactly.
know. So it's always the case.
Meanwhile, good evening, everyone. Meanwhile, if you want to interact with our today's speakers, he is Anindya Bose from Springer. So if anyone of you, because after once the session start, I think many of us, we don't get much time to interact, you know. So I think this is a perfect time where you can unmute yourself and maybe you can talk to him. Yeah. So let's see. So now, we have also learned many things, sir. Now,
Yeah.
because this Google, actually, there are so many options. If you really see
Yeah, I
it.
know.
So even all this certificate generation and all these things, we are
Correct.
doing online only. So as soon as this participant will fill the feedback link, we receive the response, so mail will go automatically to them with the certificate and all.
Correct. Sandeep, I will just share an old story with you. You know, it was in 1997
okay.
when this whole computer thing was, you know, coming to offices and people are getting accustomed with it. So we actually don't know what exactly is happening. And there was no graphic user interface, all those old setups. So people were, you know, like, what is happening? So one day they said, okay, we need some training. So CMC
okay.
was the government group. Yeah, at that time, they were coming to offices and giving trainings to all these corporates. You know. So
okay.
we few people were got selected for that. So we went there for the training. And the first thing trainer said, see, I'm going to teach you how to use Microsoft Word.
Okay.
And I only know 20% of it. So 80% I have never used. And if I can just give you 10% of the 20%, that means you know 2%. And that is good enough to do your work. So it's like such an interesting scenario. When you start working with a software, it has so many things inside into it.
Yes. That's
hats
cool.
off to those people who actually, you know, devise them and they
prepare
and create that.
Yeah.
They try to think from all corners.
Definitely, yeah. So I think
it's an amazing thing, you know, and we hardly use these softwares at all, and then we think that we are technocrats and just writing emails every day.
Yes.
So it's like it's a funny world, you know. It's very difficult to use a software completely. We hardly use it.
Yes. But because of this situation now, we are using actually many of these tools.
True,
like
true.
Earlier, like our management and department, you know, like they used to always say that okay, we should use online things and all.
Correct.
But very few people used to use, like so fortunately I was one among them.
I was using
for my this Google Classroom. There is something called as a Google Classroom. Where we can meet student virtually, student.
Yeah. My son is using that every day. So
okay.
It's his last class today before the summer vacations.
Okay.
So
okay.
He is using the Google Class. Yeah.
Yeah. So everybody is using now. Like, see, like most of them like started using this and. So because of this, I think many things are also good, but I think physical interaction is much better. Even I believe morning we were talking.
Yes. Any day. I always felt, you know,
yeah.
it's like when you go that is the whole purpose of my travels to all these conferences and going to institutes and universities. You know, the whole thing is when you know a person, and then your perception about that person changes, you can better analyze that person. Online it's fine. We just by calling and all, you remember the first time when we met, you know, and it was just all the way to your university over there, you know, which is 40 kilometers away from Hyderabad.
Yes, yes, yes.
So now we become the university, so we got more responsibility now. So
yeah, true. So you have a lot of admin activities also must have been increased, right?
Yeah, but I think they might give it to some people. I think they are looking for people, and we recently got vice chancellor. I think you must be knowing him. Like he was a vice chancellor in Usmania University, Ramchandram sir. I don't know.
Yeah.
So he's a vice chancellor for us. And if you know UB Desai, you must have heard his name.
Correct. I know UB Desai.
Yeah. So he's a chancellor for our university now.
Oh, that's interesting. You know.
Yes.
Known people, and they are all very stalwarts in their
yes,
area.
Yes. And one more person from Usmania, we have Fatima madam. She was in computer science department. And,
yes, I know.
Yeah, recently she was retired actually. So she has been offered a registrar post and she has joined, I think. Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, so many of us think they have joined.
Yeah, a lot of aggressive people are actually now joining the university.
Yeah, so they are joining slowly. Yeah. Still, we have a time, so we have around 10-15 minutes to go around.
Yeah, another 10 minutes to go.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. If they can hear me. We have a today's speaker with us, Mr. Aninda Bose. So meanwhile, if you want to interact with him, if you want to talk to him, you are most welcome, because during the session and after the session, it will be difficult to interact. So I think this is a perfect timing where you guys can interact with him. If you have any questions regarding Springer's or regarding publication, anything, yeah. And if you feel that, okay, you are not able to talk, so maybe you can post your question in chat box, yeah. So yeah, still, we'll announce this after some more time, yeah.
So good evening, sir. This is Deepika from Anura College, sir.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I have few doubts regarding the Springer publications.
Yes.
Actually, what do they mainly see in the papers, sir? When they publish the paper, most of the papers get rejected very easily at the first attempt only. So what is the basic thing with this start with?
The first most important thing in a paper, I will be discussing that also in my presentation, but the first most important thing is the scope of the paper. You know, when you select a journal, the important thing is you need to see what exactly is the scope of that paper and of the journal, and whether the scope of your paper is matching the scope of the journal.
Okay.
If there is a mismatch and they think that the target readers of that journal will not be interested for this particular paper, there is a very quick rejection on it. That is the first thing which every editorial office they check. Then there are multiple things which I will definitely try to address during my presentation, what all things their EICs basically look for. But the first thing when you see the paper is getting rejected is because of that reason. And second reason, you can say, if there is a problem with the language, that is, unfortunately, you know, in India, we don't realize that the language, what we speak and what we write, they are different. The places like China, places like Japan, places like Middle East, you know, all these academicians, they know that they are weak in English.
Yes.
The mentality in India is we are not weak at all. We can handle it very well. But unfortunate part is, you know, the way we speak, that is the way we write. But that is not the way. That is not the way to write. You know, if you giving a lecture in a class, that is entirely different from if you want to write that whole thing in a form of a chapter. Correct. So that is the second thing which they actually look for. How exactly you are putting your thoughts into it. So there are many things. First couple of things they see this. Then there are like elements also. Paper has lot many elements. If you have, I will talk about them also. And if any element is missing, to start with, immediately you know again there is a point of rejection that it will come back to you. Not rejection. Usually they come for you know make the changes, revision and all. If there is a missing element or anything. So there are different factors.
Okay, so thank you.
Yeah,
well. Sir, good evening, sir. This is Raman Kumar, sir, from Andhra University.
Good evening,
sir. Yeah, sir. This is Raman Kumar from Andhra University, sir.
Yes, sir. Good evening.
Sir, suppose when I submit for public, sending for papers for publishing in Springer series or Scopus or any other publisher, sir. When at that time it is having in Scopus database, it is appearing in Scopus and Springer and all. Once I get the acceptance, right, sir? During the acceptance also, that publisher is under Scopus database only. But once it is published, it may take little bit time now, sir, to publish that. In that.
Correct.
So at that time it is not appearing in a Scopus database. Though I may be the loser, right, sir? Then what is the solution for this, sir?
The journal is not appearing in the Scopus database, or your paper is not appearing in the Scopus database?
No, I think, my paper is not general problem asking. When I sent for publication, I got the acceptance. During that time, that is in Scopus database. At the time of publishing, it is not appearing in a Scopus database.
The journal is not appearing.
Yeah. That journal and also publisher, it is telling that in Scopus database, that the publisher is not... that publisher name is not appearing in that.
That's very unlikely, Dr. Kumar, because you know, Scopus is a database which is managed by a group which is under Elsevier.
Okay.
Now Scopus has it's an indexing body, correct? And it's a third party thing. It is not. It doesn't belong to any publisher as such, but okay. The management is from Elsevier. And what exactly Scopus is doing? Scopus is identifying good journals. Okay. And they are indexing them in their database. Now, once a journal is indexed in Scopus database, it will not go immediately. Okay. You know, that will be like, it will take a lot of time. They have to really unperform or do something very negative to be out of the indexing thing. Okay. See, what I understand from your question is basically when you apply for a particular journal and you publish your paper in it. Now, it will take some time for your paper to get indexed. Because it is not immediate. Like the journal is indexed in Scopus, but the issue in which, or the volume and the issue in which your paper has appeared, it will take some time Scopus to check that, you know. So the Springer or any publisher, they send the paper or the whole issue to Scopus. Now, Scopus will see each and every paper, whether it matches their criteria, whether it matches the criteria of the journal and all the indexing criteria, and accordingly, they will then index that paper. So, this particular period, which varies from 3 to even 9 months at times, so that is the indexing period which takes place. Otherwise, if a journal is already indexed in Scopus, it will not go out immediately. It will take time. They have to really do something negative to be out of the Scopus index.
So, good evening, everyone, once again. So, the session is not yet started. So, meanwhile, we have a speaker with us, Anindya Bose from Springer. And this is a time we are using to interact with him. So if anyone has any questions regarding publishing, regarding writing research papers, regarding anything else, so they can actually interact with him now. So they can unmute themselves. And this is a perfect timing because after this, we will not be having the much timing to interact with him. So I request the faculties and the students from other colleges, if they have any questions related to general questions. So anyway, he will be covering most of the things during the session. You can see the
Hello, sir. Sir, good evening, sir.
Hello.
Hello, good evening. Sir, good evening. Sir, sir, this is Raghavendra, sir.
Yes, Raghavendra. Good evening.
Sir, sir, sir. Actually, how many days, sir? Is it there any constraint? The general has to make a paper. These many days to take, or these many months to take to verify, like that, sir.
No, I didn't get your question. What exactly? How many days? What?
See, how many days a general can take to accept the paper? Is it there any
Okay. That's a very tricky question, you know, because each journal will take its own sweet time, because you know the review processes are very different. There are many factors behind it. But on an average, if it's a good publisher, if you go to the homepage of the journal, you will always find they mention the average time they take to accept a paper. So it will give you an idea, okay, this particular journal is taking 90 days, some journals are taking 60 days, some journals are taking 120 days. So it will give you a clear cut idea, okay, this journal will take at least 3 months to do the review on an average. Now, depending upon your work, also it changes. Suppose your work is a very focused area work and number of reviewers available are very less, then definitely it will take much more time. So there is no definite answer to this that all the journals will take this much time. It varies from journal to journal, case to case.
Okay. Sir, I have one more question, sir.
Yes, please.
Can you suggest any good journal, sir? This journal will very impact, like, you know, if you can publish the paper in this journal, will be impact, or will be impact factor is more, and the reputation of your paper also good, like that. Is there any good journal? Can you refer any journal, sir?
See, there are many journals, correct? How you select a journal? You select a journal from the journals which you usually read, or the journals which you refer, correct? So these are the journals where the journals which you are reading for your work, these are the journals where you will go and publish also, because that is the readership which you are looking for your paper also. So there is no definite answer, okay, this is the only best journal for me. There are many journals, and you can definitely look for journals. I will have a tool which I will show you how to find a journal also. So that will help you to go and select some good journals.
Okay. So specific journals also, they can concentrate only in this area, like that, is it there, sir? Or all journals can go and can go for generally?
No, there are specific journals, definitely. See, you have to select a journal which is suitable for your work only, which addresses your work, and which will be read by people who are actually working in your area. Then only your work will be cited. See, your work is not completed the moment you send it to the journal. Your work actually, you know, starts with the publishing at that point of time. So definitely, until and unless your paper is getting cited, your work is not complete, and it will be only cited when you are giving it to the correct readers. And correct readers are there when you are giving your paper to the correct journal. So it's a complete process which you have to follow, and then only it will be helpful.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Sir, good evening, sir. I'm myself a research scholar, sir. Sir, yeah. I have a doubt that many people are publishing their journals, paid journals, sir. So
which college, madam? Which college?
From Anna University, Chidambaram, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah. Sir, many people are publishing their journals in paid journals, publishing their papers in paid journals.
Correct.
Is it worth in publishing in those type of journals, sir?
See, ma'am, this particular word paid journals is basically misunderstood at many levels, right? Okay. Now, you have to see, paid journals means what? Any open access journal is where author has to pay for publishing their paper. Okay. Now, when it's an open access journal from a good publisher, the criteria are very same. Similar type of review take place, similar type of rejection and revisions takes place. So the process is very same. So when you are going to a good publisher and looking for a journal which is actually a good open access journal, you are paying, that is also a paid journal. But unfortunately, there are many journals which are like, you know, they are just appearing every day. They take money, 5,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees, and without any review, they are just publishing your paper. They are bad paid journals. So paid journals are of two types. You have to understand that very clearly. If it's a good publisher with an open access facility, that's a good journal. That is not a bad paid journal. So there is a list which is called Bial's list. If you know Bial's list, if you can go and check that today. It's B-E-A-L-L-S, Bial's. Okay. And that is a list which talks about all predatory journals. So these predatory journals are the journals which are taking money, or at times they don't take money, but they are not good journals. So you should be away from these. You should be away from these good, bad journals. They are not good. That list will tell you. Otherwise, all paid journals are good paid journals. It's not that all wherever you are giving money, they are bad. So this word paid journals has been misunderstood and not used correctly at times.
Thank you, sir. Actually, that Bial's list about bad journals, right, sir?
It's actually a list of predatory journals. Madam, he is the person who created that list and then started getting threatening calls from many publishers and many people, you know. So he stopped that. I think 3 years back, he dropped that thing. Then he was given all kind of protection and security, and all the good publishers, they talked to Bial, and then again that particular thing has reappeared. So if you go and check that list, you will find a lot of predatory journals. You have to find journals which are in your area. So that is very important, because you have to identify the journals which in your domain, because a list is always very big. You will find there are 20,000 journals, you know, listed over there. But out of 20,000, there are very few journals which are in your domain. So you have to identify that also.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So I think still people are joining, so we'll wait for another few more minutes.
Yeah, why not?
And meanwhile, like
sir, good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, this is Prem from Srinidhi, sir. Just have a small doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
I sent one paper to one publisher, sir.
Correct.
That paper publisher is in Scopus list. So okay. He accepted my paper. And everything is done. Like after 3 months, like a publisher is not in the Scopus database. And I don't know about my paper. Like when I'm checking my paper in the database, it's showing like publisher is not in the Scopus database. Like how can I communicate with them, sir? I'm not getting that exactly. What I have to do?
Yeah, I think this is the second time I'm hearing this today, that you have checked that the publisher is in Scopus index.
Yes, sir.
And okay. Usually you will find publishers are not indexed by Scopus. It's actually the books and the journals are indexed by Scopus, right? Okay. So you have to, first thing you have to see the journal in which you are sending your paper, whether that journal is indexed by Scopus.
Okay, sir.
If that journal is indexed by Scopus, I just answered someone also, it's not possible that within 3 months that journal is out of Scopus index.
Mm-hmm.
That journal has to do really something negative to be out of the indexing body. You know, it's not possible, because it takes a lot of pain for a journal to get indexing from Scopus or any indexing body. There are criteria, there are methods and processes we have to meet, a lot of criteria, then only a journal is indexed. So I think this is a classic case of where the journal was not there or the publisher was not there, and they were giving you, you know, wrong messages.
Okay, sir.
And so you have to first verify it. So first, most important thing is, you know, you should be going to good publishers. Okay. If you are going to good publishers for good journals, which are established journals, then the problem is never there. So we be very particular about selection of the journal, choosing the publisher. I'm not saying that you only go to, I will tell you about some tools also, which will help you to identify good journals. And that will really help you to find and select good journals in your area.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you. Yeah. So we'll just wait for. If there is any other questions, we can take. Sir can take few more questions now, because still people are joining. So we have people coming from the many places, and especially like southern part of India. Like we got many many colleges where the scholars
guests and faculty members have joined. And we do have a foreign delegates today. I hope, I know that they are joined today. Yes, Rajeshwar, if you have any questions.
Yeah, right now not there, but I welcome you. I'm wishing you for that.
Thank you.
So meanwhile, I request everyone to be in mute mode and during the entire session, because that will really disturb the speaker. And if you have any questions, you can always put it in the chat window, and we'll be taking those questions at the end of the sessions. Yeah. So yeah, still people are coming. So it's 4.
I think we can wait for another two minutes, and we can then start.
2 minutes.
Yep.
Oh, right. So we'll wait for, because yeah.
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
This is Balakrishna from Anurag, sir.
Yeah.
Anurag Nursery. Sir, I published one paper, sir.
Yes.
That paper copyrights will be publisher. I mean general.
Correct.
Okay, that content we can use in thesis. That content will be a self plagiarism or any other, sir.
See it. Whenever you publish a paper with any journal, so you have to sign one consent to publish or a copyright form. Yes, correct. Yes. So that means you are passing on the copyright of your content to the publisher. Whenever you want to use that for any purpose, any for your thesis or for writing another paper, you should go back to the homepage of your paper in the journal and look for something called rights and permission. Then they will help you to get that copyright back.
Okay.
Without taking copyright back, don't use that content again, because that will create a problem, which is always the problem of self-plagiarism.
Okay.
I will show you how to do it with my, whenever I am going to talk about tool today, the publishing tools, then I will show you how to do it.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Raghavendra again, sir.
Yeah. Yes, Raghavendra.
Sir, I have a small general question, sir. Sir, if I see, for example, you want to do research, sir. So when you can go for, sir, is there any mandatory you can take only transaction paper, or you can take any conference papers also? Only transaction or general paper like that we need to consider, or we can consider in the conference papers also?
You can consider anything which is in your area. When you are doing research, everything is open to you. More you read, more you know.
Okay, so there is no concern of that people will accept only transactional papers.
No, it's not like
that. What I have noticed, some people can say that only if you want to do research, you can go only transactions papers, only good papers. If you can read a conference papers, it will not give some proper information in the conference. Transaction only is the right way to go.
Raghavendra, how this publishing thing works, when a person is doing research, usually they end up with their first papers in a conference, because that is the quick way of publishing. And these papers are, you attend a conference, you present there, and you publish the paper there. But when you go for a journal, you only extend that work, you work on that paper again, add more results to it, then you go for a journal. So there are many papers which are published in conferences. The similar paper is again, with the more additional things, they go and they publish in journals. So there are many, many good papers are published first time in a conference, which may be very helpful for you. So it's not that only the papers which are published in transaction or in a particular journal will be helpful. No, I don't agree.
Okay, sir, I can extend this question, sir. I might need some more information. Sir, for example, I have taken one paper, there is a transaction paper, but the paper he implemented, the link is contains in the conference papers. See, because if you want to do one research, he divided the part into three parts, for example, three papers. Okay, two papers he published in the conference, the third
Raghavendra, sir, to interrupt you. I think we are lagging behind timing now, and it's already 4:10 now. So I think we will start. Let the people join in the middle, and we will see at the end if we have a time, and then we'll take your questions, sir. Okay, sir.
Sure. Thank you, sir.
Oh, I think somebody else is presenting. 1 minute. 1 minute. See, I request everyone. I think somebody might be using their mobile phone at all. So by default, sometime it might come as a presenting mode or something, sharing screen or all. So I request once again to mute yourself, everyone, and keep your video in off mode, unless because that will also to help us in a session to go in a smooth manner, because there might be some kind of streaming issue. Okay, so I think we will start it now. So good evening, everyone, once again on behalf of Anurag University, the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, and on myself behalf, I welcome all the participants, both faculty and student members, to this second webinar series titled Nuances of Scientific Publishing. R&D cell of Department of Computer Science and Engineering will be organizing a webinar series on different areas. And if you are interested in a pursuing research career in computer science, it's important to stay up to date with the latest trends in computer science research. So these webinars would foster interaction among students and faculty members engaged in research in computer science area. Not only computer science area, it is today's session especially, it is open to all the areas. So I welcome today's speaker, Mr. Anindya Bose from Springer Nature. Thanks for accepting as a speaker for today's session, sir. And it's my pleasure and honor to introduce today's speaker. Anindya Bose is presently working as a senior publishing editor with Springer Nature. Mr. Bose is a part of global acquisition team at Springer Nature and is responsible for acquisition of scientific content across the globe. He is responsible for acquisition of content in interdisciplinary applied sciences. He has more than 25 years of industrial experience in marketing and different fields of publishing. Mr. Bose has completed master's in organic chemistry from Delhi University and master's in marketing research from Symbiosis Institute of Management Studies, Pune. Mr. Bose has delivered more than 120 talks on scientific writing and publishing ethics in reputed university, international conference, and authors workshop. He has published books for secondary levels in chemistry and is a member of American Chemical Society, USA. Thank you, sir, for being with us today. And I have a request to all the participants. Yeah, I have a request for all the participants, like everyone be in a mute yourself, mute mode, and turn off your video for the better streaming. And post your question in the chat window, and a few questions will be selected during the question answer session after Sir's talk. And during the question answer session, feedback link will be shared. And you have to be very careful while entering your name, because the same will be used for preparing the certificates. So I hand over the session to Mr. Anindya. So please start the session, sir. So
yeah. Thank you, Sandeep. I will just share my screen. Yeah.
I will stop it now. 1 minute, because many people are coming. Yeah, can my team can okay, yeah, can you? Yes, so okay. No, you need to hide. You need to hide the, your screen is not shared. Anindya?
Yeah, I'm just doing it.
Yeah. Yeah, just hide this. Yeah, hide it. Yeah.
You can see my screen now?
Yes, we can see the screen now. you can just go for presentation. Yeah, great.
Okay, great.
Right.
Good afternoon again to all the participants, and it's a fantastic day, and let us utilize the day for our well-being. Thank you, Sandeep, especially to Dr. Vishnu and Dr. Sandeep for arranging this thing, and I'm glad to know that Anurag is now university, so it's a pleasure, and hopefully I will be visiting soon after this lockdown thing is over. I always believed in giving presentations physically, and but we have to adapt to this mode now, which is a mode which is like a webinar. So let us get into it. I would start with my talk with a dedication. I always try to dedicate the talk to someone over here, and this is a day of 29th May, which is a very historic day. 29th May 1953, Sir Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay, they reached Mount Everest. And interestingly, you know, that is a day of triumph of human endurance and skill. And right now, the whole mankind is facing such a tough situation that we have to really have show our endurance. And we have to adapt so many things. We have to make so many changes to our life. So we are, you know, there. Let's dedicate this day to Sir Hillary and Tenzing Norgay. Importantly, why I chose this image over here, where you can see they are carrying some oxygen cylinders, you know, and they are wearing some gadgets. The important thing is, whenever you go and type who reached Everest first, you know, these two persons' name appear. But there are n number of people, you know, who have they have worked behind the scenes.
Yes, Anindya, sorry to interrupt you. Yeah. I think your screen is not getting visible. Like, it's not visible.
Just a sec.
Hello.
Yeah, I will just do it again.
Yeah, I think in the middle, I think somebody was trying to publish. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, so I think it has. Yeah. So.
Someone is actually getting into it, and then.
Yes.
Can you see it now?
Yes, it's coming.
Right now?
Yeah.
Okay, so I just chose this particular image because, you know, you can see lot many gadgets and cylinders over here. And I wanted to tell you that there's a huge number of people. There's a big team of engineers really worked really hard. So everything, you know, which happens is because of a team event. It's a team which is doing it. So two people are always, you know, they are at the front line, but definitely a team has really worked hard so that this has achieved. Okay, so you can, already Sandeep has talked about me. I will just keep it brief, and because I have to cover a lot, so I will just quickly take this one by one. See, I belong to global team of Springer, and our main activity is acquisition of content. So we go and acquire content. Acquire means we talk to the authors and see what exactly they have in their research and how that actually fits to the publication mode. So whether it's a journal, whether it's a book, and whether it's our different ways like conference papers. So another important thing what we do is supporting authors. You know, that is also very important because this is the way to support authors, how to do these things. So usually we go and present. And these are the presentations which are really helpful at times because you get to learn many things what publishers are doing. I will talk about, first thing, we will talk about why publish. Second is we will see what are the ethical issues involved into it. Then we will see how to structure a manuscript. And finally, we will talk about some author services and publishing tools. The first and the very relevant question is, why write and publish research papers? See, ideally, you can say to share research findings and discoveries with the hope of improving human civilization. But these are very, very big words, which doesn't fit into the regular norms of life. You know, practically, if you see why you want to publish, to get funding so that you can do more research, to get promoted in a job. When you have a job and you get promotion, you want to keep that job with you, or you want to get a new job. For all these purposes, you want to publish. That is why you try to publish in good journals. You try to publish in journals which are indexed, where you know you get more numbers and you can score more, you can show that in your resume, and then you can actually grow. Importantly, we all look at all these points, but editors, reviewers, and the community, they do not care about these reasons. They usually, you know, interested whether you people are publishing quality or not. That is the most important thing they think of. They are least interested what is your objective behind it, but they want to see that the quality comes and quality is published and quality reaches the readers. We'll talk about the submission process, because this is the process which has been changed over the years. Now submission process is completely digital, and right now we are living in a world where our interaction is also completely digital. You know, we are talking to each other through webinars. We cannot even move out of house. So how you can do your submission process? Why there is a new change has come? But this is an easy method. You know, previously, if you go back to olden days, you will find people are using postage methods. You know, that used to take a lot of time. Like, if you want to publish a paper in a journal which is managed by a journal in Germany, from India, you have to send that paper by postage mail. The review will be done, and then again you will receive that. So this period of whole process will be like 2 years. Now things have changed totally. With the press of a button, you can send your paper. But interestingly, the revision time is something which is very important. We will talk about it. But before that, what exactly you do when you submit your work? You know, you write a covering letter, attach your manuscript, and send it to editor. This is the process which has been changed over the years. Now, what exactly you are doing? You are no more writing a covering letter, which is very important. I still insist that you go and write covering letters while submitting your manuscript. That actually helps, because when we see this chart, you will see the manuscript is going to the editor, but actually the manuscript is not going to the editor. It is going to journal editorial office, where a person who is sitting with a checklist and checks whether all the elements are there in your paper or not. So if you have a covering letter attached to it and it says what exactly your work is, then it's much easier for that journal editorial office person to check and then send your paper to the editor or associate editor. Now, what exactly they are going to do? They are going to check whether the results are novel and the topic is relevant or not. That means whatever you have done, it's a new thing, whether the topic in which you have written the paper, it is okay, it is for the journal. If it is not, it gets immediate rejection. If it is, it goes for peer review. Peer review is a review method where peer means friends, people who are your friends. Who are your friends in research? People who are working in your area, in your domain, are your friends over here. So it goes to the expert for peer review, comes back, and finally accepted. But it is not that easy. Usually it gets ended up here with revision. So your paper is getting revised. Once the revision is done, now what exactly needs to be revised? If you see, they will ask you to add new experiments, they will ask you to add improved readability and add information. Now if you really look at these points and you see, okay, I have to add new experiments, I have to add more information, if that means more experiment, more work, additional work means another 6 months work you have to do on the revision, then only you will be able to send it back, and then again it goes for publication. Before I started this presentation, someone was talking about this timeline. You know, timeline is a very tricky thing, and we know it takes a lot of time at times to get the acceptance, even to get the rejection for a paper. We usually say submission to publication time is like 3 to 12 months. Now, if you submit a paper and your paper gets immediate acceptance, then I would say it is better to look for a new journal. Rather than a new journal, you should look for a good publisher. So it's actually what is happening, why it is taking so much time for review. It is taking so much time because it depends on certain factors. Number one is manuscript type. Sometimes we don't understand the journal well, you know, and we try to send a paper which is not matching the scope of their work. So best thing is to go to the instructions, go to the homepage of the journal, look at the instructions, read the instructions properly, see the scope of the journal, and then only look at the manuscript type you have. That means whether you have an original manuscript, it's a review manuscript, it's a short paper, it's a brief communication, what exactly you have written. If it is matches with the journal, then only submit it. If you are not doing that, then probability is this, that your paper gets checked after 2 months and you will be losing 2 months when your paper will come back with a rejection note. Second is availability of peer reviewers, which is very, very important. Availability of peer reviewers is very important because suppose your paper is in a very focused area and number of reviewers available in that area is very less. So it will take much more time to review your paper. Then it is number of revisions. How many times your paper is getting revised? That is also very, very important because you have to address the reviewer comments very, very categorically and specifically so that number of revisions is reduced. If you have more number of revisions, more number of paper is coming and going back, then you are losing time and the timeline increases. We will see over here, you know, this particular pie chart, if you see, there is a green part over here which says very clearly that it is the acceptance, and that is very less, you know, part of the chart. So that means very few papers are immediately accepted when they are submitted. Most of the papers, they end up in revision. Few are rejected also. But you please note that peer review is the most positive process because there is someone out there who is reading your paper without getting any money, any recognition, and trying to help you. So it is very, very important that you understand this process as a very positive process and also help the reviewers in a way answering their queries correctly. Just imagine that you have written a paper, you have submitted that paper to a journal, and the reviewer is not able to understand your paper. Now, if a reviewer is not able to understand the language or the content of your paper, just imagine how is it possible for a reader to understand. That means your paper will be published at the end of the day, but nobody will read it. Until and unless it is read, the objective is not achieved. So important part is your paper is well reviewed, you answer the reviewer properly, and then you take it forward so that the review is done completely and you answer everything. See, what exactly helps? I always felt that the most important thing which helps in good writing is good reading. When you read well, then you write well. Now, if you look at the picture in this particular slide, you can see it's a human brain and you can have both sides visible over here, left and right. Now, left side talks about logic and right side talks about creativity. Now, if I say logic, that is more like reading part of it, and creativity is writing. So logic and creativity, these are two parts of the brain. They work together, you know. Similarly, reading and writing, they work together. If a person is well read, then the person is always able to produce a good content, and this works everywhere, not only in research. So when you read more, then you write well. How to read, that is also very important. See, now with this change of scenario, with the digital content available over there, we hardly go and buy a book or a journal. We don't read things physically, we try to download. So it is very important that we put clear-cut timing for that. Like you put 60 minutes once a week, that means 1 hour in a week just for downloading the stuff. Whatever you want to read, you download them, and then for the next 6 days you divide time for reading that. So you will find, you know, that is more fruitful, because if you are trying to download and read at the same time, that is not going to work properly. When you read, you concentrate more, so don't do any downloads at that time. Another important thing which I would like to highlight over here is like a journal club. This is a club which can be, you know, made at any level. You know, only 2-3 people can also start a club like this. You can start with your own colleagues. You can start with your own peer. So a journal paper which has been downloaded by you in your area can be read by all three of you. And then you sit and then you dissect the paper. This is a very common thing we used to do in our MSc days also. In our Delhi University, when I was studying, you know, this is something where we used to download something, we used to read that and try to dissect that paper, try to understand each other's perspective. Then it is like reading the paper correctly rather than reading alone. Now we will get into the ethical issues. Ethical issues are very, very important, because I feel the most important thing is discipline in life. So when you have ethics, then only you will be a good researcher, then only is it is possible to be a good human being. I will ask you a few questions. You can, I usually ask them and get the answers when I physically present it, but I will just give you the answers over here one by one. So it will help you to understand the magnitude of this publishing world. It will help you to understand how many people are actually involved and how big or small this whole industry is, and how, why there are delays, why there are, you know, people with so many questions, and why the answers are sometimes remains unanswered, questions remains unanswered. You know, I will just ask you, how many papers are published worldwide in a year in English language journals? So here the question is, if you think about how many English language journals are there, how many journals are there in different disciplines which they publish in English language? So I'm talking about the number of papers over here. So how many papers are there, do you think? Just think about that number in your mind. I will give you the answer over here. Is like 1.8 million papers published worldwide each year. It's a huge number of papers which are getting published each year. Just think about it. The papers which are not published, either the submitted papers which are not published, either they are in revision or they are rejected, and more research is being going on in that area. So 1.8 million papers is actually the 30% paper which are getting published in a year, and 70% more papers are getting rejected. So just imagine how many papers and how many authors are involved in 1 year when publication takes place. So if I say, how many books are published worldwide? So the first question which comes to my mind is, are these books numbers are more than journal articles, or they are less than journal articles? You know, most of the people will think, when I was looking at these numbers, I also, you know, thought in the same way, that number of books are less and number of articles are more. But interestingly, if you see, the number of books are 2.2 million books published worldwide each year. So number of books are much more than even number of articles. So when we are going to talk about ethics here, I just ask you, how many researchers have committed research fraud at least once in their career? You know, if we look at this number in percentage, then how many researchers have committed research fraud? This number is actually very small. This is like 1.98%. But interestingly, if you look at the numbers which I have given in my previous questions, that is 1.8 million papers, 2.2 million books, that means 4 million content which is getting published, you know. So 1.98 or 2% of that author base is also a very, very big absolute number. So just imagine how much unethical activities are happening. We will come to another question. I will just tell you what exactly it is. What is the most occurring reason for retraction? First important thing, you will see, first, what is retraction? You know, retraction is like when we used to have this publication in print way, print mode, it was not possible to do any retraction because the book is printed or the journal is printed, the purchaser or the reader has already got the book in his hand. So you cannot go back and retract anything from that. But with the online publishing, with the digital publishing, there's a possibility that you can go and you can take that paper away from the online platform. That is called retraction. When we see retraction because of unethical practices, the first thing which comes as an answer is honest error. That is 40% people are doing honest error. Because why there is an honest error? Because people don't know they are committing an error, but they are doing it because they don't know the rules, they don't know the policies. Then there is fabrication and falsification. This is like with internet, you know, it's easy. You can go, you can download something, use the results for your own work, you can fabricate it. So 28% papers are retracted because of that. Then there is like self-plagiarism, and then there are other methods. The important part is copyright. I don't want you to read the copyright definition over here. Which I want to highlight over here is the word which is written COPE, which is COPE. This is Committee on Publication Ethics. You can go to this particular website, COPE.com, and you will find a lot of data which is presented in question and answer form, and you will get to see a lot of policies and very, very lucidly and very beautifully a two-pager, three-pager document which will help you to understand all different ethical issues. So you can go to COPE website and you can read more. See, the whole idea of this presentation is to tell you the places or the tools which you can go and you can use them, you know, because it is not possible in 45 minutes or 1 hour to teach you everything. It is just we can touch upon certain aspects which will help you to understand them, and then you can go and research more in that area. You can use those tools, you can read more. Simultaneous submission. What is simultaneous submission? Simultaneous submission is submitting the same manuscript to the multiple publishers at the same time. Now, why it is a problem? Why simultaneous submission is a problem? I have my paper. I want to publish this paper in a journal. I can send it to 5 different journals at the same time. But this is unethical. Why this is unethical? Because when you are sending your journal article to the 5 journals at the same time, now these journals will actually take your paper to the next level, that is the review level. Who are the reviewers? Reviewers are very, very small number of people. Now, interestingly, if you look at this industry, the authors and readers, they are the same people. The authors are the readers and readers are the authors. And similar, these authors and readers, they are the reviewers. So these are the number of people who are available for reviewing your work. So if all the journals are sending your work to the reviewers, 5 journals sending it to 5 different reviewers means it's a waste of time, waste of effort, and waste of resource for that particular work. So simultaneous submission is unethical in that way. Similarly, you have multiple submissions. Multiple submission means sending several different manuscripts to the same publisher. This is again unethical because, you know, if you are sending 5 manuscripts to the same publisher, this is happening very rampantly when you are using a special issue, a set of editors who are creating that special issue, they are using their own people and publishing their work. Sometimes it is happening in conferences, like a conference done by Anurag University, take for example, and Anurag University is doing that conference and they are publishing 30% or 40% papers from Anurag University only. Then it is, you know, it's a multiple submission. These are unethical. Now the buzzword is plagiarism. Plagiarism is something which everyone understands, but everyone hates. Nobody likes this word to be used. So people are getting smarter nowadays. They don't use the word plagiarize. They use the word, you know, similarity. They use the word different words for synonyms for these plagiarism. But plagiarism is actually, it occurs when someone presents the work of other people, you know, without acknowledging their work or without taking permission. But there is something called what is fair use. You can use someone else's work in a fair way. You can go to this particular document, Association of Research Libraries 2012. If you just type this in Google, you will find this document. And this will help you to understand how much is actually the fair use. How we get to know about plagiarism, I will just tell you, because as a publisher, we get sometimes we get the information. The original author is the first person we get to know from him. The original author sees, oh, my work has been copied by someone else. So he gives an alert. Sometimes reviewer, very seldom. But reviewers, they read a lot. So sometimes they get to know this work has been published somewhere. You know, they don't, at times, they don't remember where, but they tell us. And lastly, you will find researchers who are like whistleblowers. They come across 2 different articles at the same time, which are similar. So they come back to us and tell us, okay, these are the papers which are plagiarized. So we know there's a tool which helps in plagiarism, correct? Checking plagiarism, basically. But I will say it cannot identify plagiarism. It takes a human eye to identify plagiarism because tool cannot do that. This is a plagiarism tool which we usually use in our Springer, Authenticate. There are many others, Turnitin, Dopalock and all. So this is the inside story which you will see usually. This is the number of percentage of similarity or overlapping which is there. This is a very beautiful, colorful paper, but unfortunately color is not good everywhere. You know, you'll find this paper is 93% plagiarized, 39% from the single source. So I'll give you some basic tips over here, how to see this plagiarism, how these tools they work and how to go about this plagiarism thing. The first thing, tool cannot detect all problems. That is the most important thing which you have to understand, because tool gives you a similarity percentage. When you run your paper within a tool, tool will show you, okay, 20% plagiarized or 20% similar. That doesn't mean that your paper is plagiarized. You know why? I will tell you. Suppose there are 2 papers, X and Y. Y has 20%. There are 2 papers, I say. Y has 10% plagiarism and X has 30% plagiarism. Now, if you look at the numbers, then X is more plagiarized. But if I say that why is direct copy of the results and the methods, although it is still 10%. That means 10% is more dangerous than 30%, because this 30% is not direct copy. Maybe from here and there they have picked up some data. Second is, what I said, a low similarity score does not mean there is no plagiarism. It is important to look at the individual scores or the sources, which I showed you in my previous slide, that there is a 93% plagiarized, but 39% coming from a single source. So you have to see that also, whether that is coming from where it is coming from. If a single source is very high, then definitely there are more possibility of plagiarism. Now, setting a standard above or below certain similarity index is misusing the tool. You know, at times you will find many people come to us and they say, what is the limit? You know, whether we should put it as 20% as a limit, or we should put 30% as a limit. This is something which I don't follow, and I don't suggest also. I will not advise doing that, because if you are putting a limit over there, there's a possibility that if you put 20% as a limit, there's a possibility that 25% similarity is more less dangerous than 19%. So there is always a scope of misusing the tool. Now, only publications by participating publishers or societies, which are the part of the cross-check database. Common phrases are not excluded. You use a common phrase, it is present in paper, so it is always highlighted. Text for permission, you have taken permission, but still it will be highlighted by the tool, because tool is not aware that you have taken permission from the author. Review articles are always review of another article, so you will always find that review articles are always a problem with more similarity. Patchwork plagiarism, this is the most difficult thing to evaluate, but obviously there are patchwork, people are smart, they know how to use those different content differently, so there is a plagiarism of this nature also. Self-plagiarism is something which you have already published, and again you are doing it, and you are not taking copyright or permission back from the journal, so it is a self-plagiarism, which is the most dangerous form of plagiarism, which is like an honest error. Data fabrication and falsification, I told you this. This is like fabrication and falsification is something which already the data is available and you are taking it from internet or some other source and fabricate it and falsify it and use it. So general advice is verbatim copying should be put in quotation marks. If you have verbatim copying, please put it into quotation mark. Give credit to the original author. Always take permission from the publisher. And if you are using figures and tables from any work, whether it's your work or someone else's work, please take permission before using. This is a homepage of one article which is published in Springer. I will just tell you how to take the permission back. And you can see in this homepage of your article, there is a button called reprints and permission. If you just go to the reprints and permission, you will be taken to this particular page rights link. Suppose you want to publish two figures from your existing work, which is published in Springer Journal or any good publisher's journal. So you can see, you know, you go to rights and permission, go to the rights link page, and then you can make a selection. Okay, I want to use figure number this and this in my work again. Usually, if you are doing it for your personal use or any journal publication, then they don't charge. But if you are doing it for a book and you have a royalty attached to it, then there is a possibility that sometimes publishers, they charge for it. If you are using IEEE content, which you have published in IEEE and want to publish it somewhere else, then there is a possibility that IEEE charges you. Coming to the third section, that is structuring your manuscript, which is very interesting, how to structure your manuscript. Now, for structuring your manuscript, we always believe there's a story, although it's not once upon a time, but story is always where you have a beginning, you have a middle, and you have an end. You have certain sections which are mandatory. I will just talk about them. We always tell that as an IMRAD model. What exactly is IMRAD? IMRAD is nothing, it's not a rocket science, it's simple. IMRAD is introduction, methods, results, and discussion. These are the four elements which are always present in the manuscript. If you look at the expanded part, which the first part is title, second is abstract, third is keywords, then you have the IMRAD, and finally you have references and acknowledgement. This is the structure mostly followed by most of the journals. So this is the something which needs to be built on, and then you have to create your story in each section. We will touch the sections now. Before going to the section, I will just ask you one question. Just think about it. When you write a paper, that means you are drafting a paper. You are doing your work, you are not finalizing your paper, you are just drafting your paper. What is the first thing you are going to write? The first thing out of these elements, what is the first thing you are going to write in your paper? The first thing which you will write is actually methods and results, because you are performing certain methods and you are getting certain results. So this is the first thing which you will write. Once you have the methods and results drafted, then you go and select your target journal, because you will find in the instruction page they will always tell you how to write introduction, what is the word limitation of introduction, how many paragraphs to be used for discussion. There are many different instructions you will get. So always better to select the journal first, then write introduction and discussion, and lastly you should write title and abstract. Why lastly you should write title and abstract? Because title is summarization of the experiment which you are doing, and abstract is the summarization of your whole work. So once your other sections are ready, then only you can summarize them. This is how you should write, the order in which you should structure your paper. What is the importance of your title? The first thing is the title which gets highlighted, the first thing which grabs the reader's attention, introduces your manuscript to an editor when you are sending it. It is the label which is used for indexing. So very, very important, convey the main topics of your manuscript. Be specific and concise, avoid jargons, don't use abbreviations. If it is like a very, very general one like DNA, accepted. Otherwise, in your area, if you are using some abbreviation, maybe known to your community, but don't use it in title. First impression count. What is the first impression in digital world? Very interesting. Whenever I go and try to see any paper digitally, try to download that paper, the first thing I can see is the title, and second is abstract. I cannot see the whole paper until and unless I purchase that paper. So what is the first thing I will see? Abstract. So it is the first impression which counts. Relevance of your aim should be there in your abstract. Importance of your result should be there. You should not talk about your results. You should not present your results. You should only say the importance of your results. Validity of your conclusions. These are the three important parts you should mention in your abstract. Abstract will judge your writing style. And abstract is the only part sometimes read by readers, because if they don't understand the abstract well, they will never download your paper. So it has to be very clear, very specific, and very, very clearly written in the English language so that they understand it very well. People know, okay, this is the paper I am looking for. Interestingly, if I give you an anecdote over here, you know, it's a story which I visited one company once, and they said, we have an abstracting and indexing department. So I was a little curious to know what exactly abstracting department is doing. So what exactly you are doing? So they said, sir, abstract, we can write abstracts. I said, but author is the only person who can write abstract of their paper. How you can write an abstract? But there is an industry which is a very big industry in India. Its turnover is around 200 crores. Like, people are sitting there taking papers and they are creating abstracts with tools and with their experience. That is something which is they are doing a lot. Even for writing PhDs, you know, there's a 300 crore industry in India for writing PhDs. Sometimes we receive mails from people, you know, it is very difficult to even decipher the meaning of the mail, but you just look at the PhD, what they have written, it's fantastically written. Someone else has actually written it. So get away from all these unethical things and do your own work. That is the most important thing. And when you write abstract well, it will take some time to understand how to do it. You have to work, rework, get it checked by peer, give it to your mentor. They will help. A lot of that, sometimes you get rejections, but definitely that will improve. Introduction. What is the introduction part? It again, it has a story, beginning, middle, and end. It's like introduction, answers, the why part of your work, what question was studied. Introduction, you start at the beginning. Do not write comprehensive literature review of the field. That is the most important thing, because when you are writing your first paper, you always have the tendency to write more and more, because you have studied so much about your work, so you want to put everything over there. But don't do that. If you have more things to put, just put it in the form of references, and so that people can refer them. Do not write comprehensive literature review, cite the reviews. Introduction part, which is the middle part of introduction, which what is the rationale and reason for your study, please put it. Explain how you address these problems in one or two sentences only. Do not state results from your study here. That is the most important mistake which people do. very, very frequently people put the results in the introduction section. And that is the first section people read, reviewers read, and they find, oh, they have mentioned the results and the paper is again sent back for revision. So please do not state results from your study here. End part, clearly state the specific aims of your study, state the methods you will use to carry your aims, and put the citations in a very balanced way. That means current and relevant citations and old and new citations in a balanced format. Materials and methods, very, very important. The first thing which you have written, when I said the right order, when you are finalizing, it has to be in a clear subheadings. Describe methods in the past tense. New methods must be described in sufficient detail. If it's a new method which you have used, please describe it in a very, very detailed way. But if it's an old method which you are using, established method, don't go for explanation and just reference it so that there is no possibility of overlapping of content from your previous work or someone else's work. Describe the statistical test. Then you have the section called results. Results, again, you have to have use proper subheadings, use past tense to describe results. But whenever you are referring to figures and tables, please, please put them in present tense. Present the facts, do not discuss your results. Discussion is a different section. Please put the results in this section. Please do not discuss them here. Do not duplicate the data among figure, tables, and text. You know, figures and tables should be standalone. You can read the caption, you can understand it well if I can see and decipher the meaning out of it. If I have to go back and read it in the content part, then it is the duplication of the data. Please don't do that. Include results of statistical analysis in the text. Like I said, figures and tables are very effective. Again, I am saying avoid duplication with the text. Label all parts of your figures. Legends or the captions must be standalone. If I read the caption, I understand the figure well. Last part of your last element of your section, which is discussion. Discussion is the which actually says so what. Usually you will find this is the most difficult section for authors to write. First and foremost thing is you be humble. Do not overstate the importance of your results, because if you are doing it, again, there is a chance that it will come back to you for revision. What is the beginning part? Answer the research question correctly. Always provide the major or the main result first. Don't beat around the bush. Don't say these are the my results which I have received and then go to the final one. Please don't do that. Go and talk about the first and the main result first, because nobody has time to read everything at times. Now give your conclusions based on the results. Middle part, interpret the results. Now these results, are they related to your previous work? If they are, please compare them, whether it's same or different. If it is not, then present them in a different way. Possible reasons you should mention why it is. And briefly describe the limitations. If you don't describe the limitations of your work, reviewers will definitely ask for it and they will return your paper for review. End part of the discussion, reiterate your conclusions. Like, you know, we always have a signpost or signal, like in conclusion, in summary. When you read that word, in summary, that means, you know, okay, you are end part of your work. So possibly you give the applications and implications properly, suggest future work. Now, suggesting is something which is not mandatory. If you think that it is, you can suggest, it is very important. If you don't know what to suggest, you can leave it, don't suggest anything. References are in two forms, numbered and name date. You will find they are called Vancouver and Harvard styles. Vancouver is a numbered style. Harvard is a name date style. Name date means Rawat 2016, Bose 2017. This is the style which we follow. There are many, many reference management softwares which are available by payment or at times they're free, like RefWorks, Mendeley, EndNote, Zotero, Papers. You can use them. They have many other users. They connect you to social sites, and you can keep things. So there are many things you can do with them. You can just go download any one of them and play with them. Coming to the last section, just have a sip of water. Coming to the last section, that is the author services and publishing tools. To quickly run through some tools and publishing services which are here, you can go back and you can actually play with them. Why I say play with them? Because, you know, when I started my career, we started with computers, you know, that we were very new to the systems and all. And we used to play a solitaire a lot. And that is how we used to have our control over mouse and control how to use things. So when you start playing with things, you start learning things on your own. So these are all apps. These are all tools which you can go, you can download. Some of them are free, some of them are paid. But there are maximum of them are free, which you can go and you can use them. So this is the, I will give this presentation to Sandeep so that he can send it this to all of you. So you have all these things with you and you can check them one by one. So just go and use them. I will just run through them over here quickly. Author and reviewer tutorial. This is a page which is in Springer. If you go to any other publisher's page also, website, you will find these pages are very common. But this is something which will help you to understand. If you go there, there are many question and answers and many videos which will help you to understand the work of author, how reviewers they work and all. These are tutorials. Very interesting tool over here called Reviewer Finder, because this is a challenge when you work sometimes. Now most of the journals are looking for reviewers. They, whenever you submit your paper, they said, okay, please tell us who are the reviewers, give us some names. So it is always good to know reviewers in your area. So this is a tool which you can use for finding reviewers. OA funding support is a page which is like in the US and Europe. When you get the publishing grant, you know, there you get when you get the research grant, then you get the publishing grant also attached to it. But in India, unfortunately, we don't get publishing grant much. So it's always good to look for funders. This is a page which is an OA funding support page. If you go to Springer and look for this page, springer.com, then you will find this is really helpful. You know, you can talk to these funders directly and you will talk about waivers, and they sometimes they publish your paper, they sponsor it. So it will help you to go into a open access mode. Author Mapper, this is developed by Springer long back, and this is like a lovely software which we usually use. This we use when we go to a new university. Most of the time salespeople or like editors like us, suppose we go to Anurag University and I want to know how many people have really published good papers in computational intelligence, then I can do that, you know, with this software. So what I have done yesterday, you know, I was just looking for a city called Hyderabad over here because I'm presenting for Anurag. And I put the subject computational intelligence and I put date range of 1 year. You have more options over here. Now this date range says 1 year, 2019, 28 May to 2020, 28 May. Now I use this string and I said search. So there are 1479 articles, 1479 articles in computational intelligence published in Springer from Hyderabad in 1 year. So if you can go to this particular button over here, export CSV, then you can export these list of the papers. Then there are links. You can go to the home page. You can see. So if it is your area, it really helps. How it helps? It helps in exploring the pattern in scientific research. It will help you to identify new historic trends. And it will help you to locate experts in your field. People who are writing in your area are the people who should be contacted for your work also. Collaboration is the key nowadays. You can find more people in your area, you can collaborate with them. Author Mapper is a big helping tool in that way. Recommended. Recommended is another tool which is very helpful in a way. I will tell you, you know, nowadays you must have seen, you go to your university website and you search something and you come out, you go to Flipkart and then you look for a product, you close it and you come back to your university site again. You will find the product which you were looking for in Flipkart is actually, they are coming over there and they are saying, you know, with the banners over there, maybe you are looking for an air conditioner. They will popping up advertisements of air conditioner. You know, this is the whole idea behind this. Recommended is a tool where 45,000 journals are covered. So you can go and register yourself freely. What they will do, they will see what all areas you work in and what all papers you are downloading. They will try to understand your behavior and then they will send you an alert. See, when I say 45,000 journals, then I say again 2 million papers. Now, out of these 2 million papers which are published in 1 year, that means 4,500 papers are published in 1 day. There's a possibility that none of the papers are in your area. But definitely there is a possibility that some papers are in your area, but are very difficult to find. recommended is a tool which is AI driven, which will help you to find the papers in your area. Overleaf, this is a paid service, it's a paid tool, but sometimes they give a lot of waivers to countries like India. You can see this is for collaborative writing and publishing. So it is, these are like more, you can go and you can explore more. Interesting tool, ShareDit. ShareDit is very interesting because it gives you an opportunity to share your work legally, complete work. Like the first and the important thing when you publish a paper in a Springer journal, you want to tell people. When you send the link to people, they cannot open your paper, they can only read the abstract. Because they have to buy to read the paper or purchase it. But interestingly, ShareDit gives you an option to legally send your paper to people and they can see the whole paper. They cannot print it, they cannot download it, but they can annotate and they can read the whole paper. How it works in a reverse way, which is more interesting for me, suppose you are looking for a paper in Springer and you find that paper is very useful, but you don't have subscription, you cannot buy that paper because it is like 25 euros you have to pay. You go to the homepage of the paper, write to the corresponding author, please share it with me. He can freely share that paper with you. So you have a legal access to the paper instead of illegal way of looking forward to downloading papers. ORCID ID is like a Aadhaar card for all the research people who are doing. If you don't have ORCID ID, please go and register yourself today itself. Because if you have ORCID, then it gives you a proper citation. It helps you to identify yourself in the research community in a proper way. The source, a very interesting blog. You can go and write blogs there. You can go and search jobs there. You can look for career there. And there are many things you can do. So you take help of this particular, our author and partner marketing services team is basically has developed this and they are managing this. You get to know so many new things if you go to source and read. Nature Masterclass is a class where, you know, the scientific writing and publishing courses are run by very, very senior editors. And this is something very expensive. At individual level, I don't think you will be able to go. You can see sample copies which are freely available if you go to Nature Masterclass website. But definitely universities can go and explore and you can help your university to understand and the teams can join and get benefited from these classes. Finally, before I go to last slide, it is like sign up for the free daily Nature briefing. This is a very interesting thing. I have also signed up for Nature briefing and it's a free service on the weekdays, like first 5 days, not Saturday, Sunday. You get the briefing, quick briefing of scientific world. And there's a saying over here, it says reading the Nature briefing is the first thing I do when I go to the lab, turn on my computer every morning. I have recommended it to all my students. That is a very, very interesting way of moving the world. Now you get a lot of messages on Corona because that is the most popular thing which is going around. Couple of books before I say thank you before to you all. Couple of books I would say introduce. This is a fantastic book, How to Write and Publish a Scientific Paper, written by Robert A. Day. He is known as father of scientific writing, which talks about all kinds of publishing nuances, which is available. I think it's 1,000 rupees or something it costs in Flipkart or Amazon. You can go and buy. There's another good book which is called Getting It Published, written by William Germano. This is again the nuances of all publishing. What exactly is copyright? Why there is a series editor? What is volume editor is doing? Why there's a patent? All these terminologies will be clear once you go. These are like reference books. These are not like you have to read it once again and again. You can go back to these books and use it. There are two more books which are like a textbook of research ethics by Sana Lu, which is, I find it very nicely written. You can go and read it. It has been used by many universities as a textbook. And recently we have published this 2 years back, Engineering Research Methodology, and this is another interesting book. So you have a lot of resources now with you. You can go, I will give this presentation to Sandeep. You can go back, you can check them, you can play with them, as I said before, use it to the fullest and learn more, read more. The more you read, you will definitely able to write well. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions right now, you can give it through chat box. I think Sandeep will be able to coordinate that and we can answer.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for your session. I hope everyone is able to hear my voice. Hello.
I can hear you.
Yes, sir.
Can you hear my voice?
Yeah, here. Yeah, audible, yeah, sir. Audible.
Audible, right. So thank you very much, yeah, sir.
So yeah, yeah. Now, thank you.
Okay, before taking the questions, I think the team has already given the feedback link in the chat box. So I request all the participants to give the feedback and maybe wait for 1 or 2 minutes. Maybe wait for 1 or 2 minutes to, you know, like to generate the certificate.
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Yeah, meanwhile, I will take the questions. So I request everyone to be in a mute mode only because taking question from everyone will be not possible now. So what we'll do, I think, let me just go one by one. I think
if someone has any specific question, you can write to me also. My email ID is there, ando.bolt@gmail.com.
Yes.
Can I ask you something, sir? Hello?
Yeah. Kindly share the link again, team. Rajesh.
Hello, my name is Rajesh.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir. It was a good session. First of all, thank you for exploring the very great things in publication tools, especially. Thank you for that one. It would be better that it will be continued to 1 more hour if it is possible, but due to the time lag, okay. But my question is, sir, I want to know the difference between DOI and Web of Science factors. Digital Object Identifier will be there, sir. DOI.
Yeah.
And Web of Science. That difference I want to know, sir.
See, you want to know the what exactly is DOI first, and then you want to know what is Web of Science.
Web of Science, yeah.
Yes.
Correct. See, first I will talk about Web of Science. Web of Science is a platform, it's an indexing platform for a company which is called Thomson Reuters. Thomson Reuters started in 1970s, 73, 74 beginning, and they started with this Web of Science indexing body. They indexed 6,500 American journals and 2,000 journals from the rest of the world. Now they have some 12,000 journals indexed in Web of Science. Now it is owned by a different company which is called Clarivate Analytics. Correct? This is Web of Science. It's a company and indexing body. Now, talking about DOI, DOI is Digital Object Identifier. That means anything which is published digitally, like a chapter or article, we give a identifying link to that, which is called DOI. So with that DOI, whenever you publish a paper or whenever you publish a book chapter, you will find first page down there, you will find there is a DOI number is written.
Yeah.
So, you know, in previous days, whenever we used to go to library, there used to be, I don't know whether you have seen them or not, there are index cards, you know, and looking at those index cards, you can identify the book where it's kept. These are again like library cards for each and every document. Each document is identified that way. It's a digital object identifier, we call it. Digitally, the object, your paper, is getting identified by that number.
Yeah, okay. Sir, by using DOI, can we identify the publication?
Yes, every paper or each paper and each chapter which is digitally published has a DOI.
Yeah, okay. Okay, sir, thank you.
Can I have a question? I'm taking one of the question from the PPT.
Yeah.
One of the participant, I think her name is Priya. She's asking the difference between SCI and SCIE. Priya Lakshmi.
Correct.
She's the participant, yeah. So what is the difference?
See, SCI is again scientific citation index. It is like, you know, started by the same group like Reuters, and that is also known as Web of Science. That is also Web of Knowledge, or that is also known as SCI indexing. Now, when SCI has, like I said, around 12,000, and the exact number is 11,665, you know, journals are indexed in SCI. But there are many good journals. They are coming new. They want also to be part of SCI, and they are applying for SCI indexing. So they started with SCIE, which is the expanded form. SCIE is the first step towards going to SCI. So you first get SCIE indexing, Web of Science, from, and then if you are selected and you meet all your criteria, then you can go to SCI after maybe 2 years or 3 years.
Okay.
Hope I answered.
Yeah, yeah. So thank you. Thank you very much. And maybe we can take one more question quickly. And most of the people, actually, they have requested for PPTs, which I'm going to share in whatever
mail. Yes, I will give you the PDF to you so that you can immediately send it. Yeah.
Sure. And meanwhile, like, if anyone, one more question we can take now.
Yeah.
Is there anyone?
Yes, sir. Can I take, sir? This is Raghavendra. Can I take the question?
Okay.
Sir?
Okay. Yeah, we have one more question from this. Then
sir, actually I have told you, sir, three papers are there. The third paper is output of the 1 and 2, like, you know, extension of the 1 and 2. Third paper is published in Transaction. 1, 2 published in conference papers.
Correct.
Okay. So if I want to take the Transaction paper, okay.
Yes.
See, how can I justify that these two are the very good papers? Because the people are not yet accepting when you go for these two, and I can show conference papers. But they are always pointing, it is not a conference, you can go always Transaction only, like that.
See, I told you before also, see, publication can be done in different forms. Like here we are talking about journal and conference. There are ways of publishing. You can publish your work in the form of a book chapter also. So it is not mandatory that an article which is published in Transaction has the best value. It's not. If you have three papers also, and two papers are published in conferences, and third is an extension of that, so definitely they are interrelated to each other. So whenever you are going to present anything, so you present all three papers and reference them to each other. Or if you have already included 1 and 2 in the third paper, then definitely you can talk about your third paper, and because you are already referring 1 and 2 there, so it doesn't make any difference as
well. Okay, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir. We have one more question, last question. This is given by Sai Kiran Yadav, and his question is, what do you suggest, as is it better to work together or work self? Is there any similarity with others? What are the publishing in a paper? I think that is what the question is. Like, I think what I understood is whether we should work in a team or whether we should publish a work separately, individually.
this is a very interesting question. I always believed in team, and I believe team always helps. But there are many papers which are published at individual level. You will find single authored papers, single authored books, but you know, research is not possible single-handedly, and it's always a collaboration which helps. If you look at the universities right now, even the ranking of the institutions, people are not looking at the merits of students or teachers. They want to see how many collaborations these universities they have, you know, what kind of a team effort they are building. So it is very important that I feel it is very important that you should work in a team.
Okay.
Team all.
Okay. So thank you very much. Thank you once again, all the participants. And I request Deepika ma'am to propose a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Sadeep.
Thank you,
sir. Good evening, everyone. I am Deepika, Assistant Professor, Department of CSE from Anurag University. I'm honored and lucky to have the opportunity to give a vote of thanks on this special day. I particularly like Mr. Aninda sir's session, where he mentioned the importance and need of scientific publishing. The way he explained was extraordinary. I would like to thank Mr. Sandeep Rawat sir for organizing this wonderful webinar. I would like to thank our HOD and Deputy Director, Mr. G. Vishnumurthy sir, for encouraging to conduct this webinar. I would like to thank our Dean, CSE IT, Mr. Vijay Kumar sir and our director Mr. K.S. Rao sir for participating and encouraging in this event. I must not forget to thank the organizing team and faculty members who contributed to organizing this event until the last day of the week. Finally, I would like to thank all the participants for participating in this webinar. I would like to thank you again for making this event successful. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, Deepika.
Thank you very much, madam. Now, I think this is the end of the session. So thank you very much, everyone. And for the future event, we'll be sending you mails and brochures and all. So stay tuned with us and we'll be sending the details. Thank you, Aninda sir, once again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you, Aninda sir.
Yeah, yeah. I think we have a Dr. Vishnu sir with us as well. Okay, Aninda sir left, I think. Yeah. Thank you, everyone. Yeah. So please fill your feedback form and you'll be getting the certificate soon after submitting the your feedback link. And whatever the mail IDs you have given here, our team will send the these PPTs, PDF file presentation from after getting the, from speakers, we will be sending to the all the participants. So thank you once again. Thank you very much. I think we have one participant from Malaysia. I think Dr. Hamid is there. So thank you very much, sir, for attending from all the way from the Malaysia. So thank you. So yes, sir. Thank you.
I think no problem regarding the certificate, sir. Everyone got the certificate. Sir.
Everyone got, yeah, yeah. So,
yeah, then no problems. Yeah. Everyone correct info. Put the information correctly on this.
Okay.
Till now 136 responses.
That is 136, huh?
Yes. Okay.
That means everyone has filled, yeah. Maybe after, immediately after 1 or 2 minutes, you can stop receiving the responses.
You can mention it in chat, I guess.
Yeah, as soon as we finish this members, yeah, as soon as we close this session, then Raghavendra sir.
Sir.
Yeah, your mic is on. Yeah, so.
Sorry,
yeah.
Sir.
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay. Yeah.
I forget, sir.
No, it's okay.
So, Sandeep Rawat, sir.
Yeah, so maybe
Deepika,
madam.
Awesome.
I think what is your score now?
It's 141.
No, we can stop now, I think. Because I think most of the people, those who have already this one.
If we cut this call, we can stop, sir. Still people are
there. That's right. So we'll stop this.
Okay.
And we'll stop recording. We'll stop